All right, and let's get to it. Everybody, welcome back to Elevating the Genre, episode 10. We are your co-hosts. I'm Christopher Morrison, and that gentleman is...
Dominic. And I have to ask you something immediately, is, Chris, are they selling Star Wars tickets in your country now, in Belgium?
Probably, I don't know.
To the next movie? Because they definitely started selling them in the UK, like maybe yesterday.
Then more than likely, yeah. Yeah, we get it at least a week early.
You get it earlier.
We get it early, ladies and gentlemen. I guess the rumor is that it's to help cut down on piracy. I don't know. I guess they fear more piracy overseas than they do on the U.S. soil. I don't know if that fucking works. Okay. I don't know if there's.
Then we're just talking about advanced ticket sales.
Yeah.
There are people still... I mean, I did this whole thing last year for So I Can Slay. Like, I hovered over the thing.
Yeah.
I got 10 tickets for opening night the second it came out, just by lucky refreshing.
Mm.
And I really wanted... It was a high nerd achievement of the year, and I wanted to unlock that achievement again this year.
Yeah.
And see the shit on opening night, because I'm very excited about Rogue One. And they've been dancing around it, and they've not said anything about when they're starting to sell tickets in America.
Okay.
And yesterday they started selling tickets to, mind you, it's premiering December 15th or whatever.
Yeah.
They started selling advance tickets in, you know, at least the United Kingdom.
I'm really surprised it's not in the States already. That's shocking. That's really weird to me that they wouldn't have that already. But it might be here. I don't know. I'll be honest with you. This is Brussels, Belgium. So the first time I've ever run into ticket problems was literally last night when my wife and I decided to try to go see the new Harry Potter movies dropped over here already. It was the first time ever I went to the booth, and again, it was opening weekend, and they had sold out. That was like the first time I'd ever even come close to running into that problem. I don't know if that's a Harry Potter thing, or it was literally, sorry, that wasn't last night, that was Sunday night. It was literally a Sunday night at an 8 o'clock showing, so like obviously that maybe it was pretty popular, and it was rainy as shit and awful out as usually is in Brussels, so maybe that was a popular showing or whatever. But that's the first time I've never had any problems going opening night. I didn't have any problems opening night for episode 7, night for any of the Marvel movies, like no problem whatsoever. Again, we have options.
Same
here.
I mean,
we have options here. We have the version original, so that's the English version with the dual subtitles, because again, Belgium, you get French and Flemish subtitles. And they have, and you have the usually the version française, so the French dubbed version with Dutch subtitles. But anyway,
I feel sure that's a Harry Potter thing. That's just Harry Potter.
It might be a Harry Potter thing. Yeah, I mean, it's just me underestimating that Harry Potter's a badass. You know, Harry Potter's the property these days. You know, the supreme property these days. I don't know. Anyway, we didn't even finish the intro. We got right into it, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, sorry. That was the most critical thing I had to ask you immediately. Whether or not you had a ticket to this Star Wars movie.
I don't yet.
On your comfortable side of the world in the Magic Kingdom of Brussels.
Yes. I will is probably the answer soon. I shouldn't have a problem.
Well, good for you.
Yes, good for me. So there. I don't even know the actual release date here. I have to look it up. But anyway, we are here just as obviously we just did. We're here to talk about all things that make smart, geeky stuff actually smart. Well, we talked about some geeky stuff. We didn't talk about what makes it smart. I guess we talked about what makes it smart to live in Brussels if you're a geek, I guess. Hooray!
Smart. Smart move.
Smart move on my part.
Get the shit earlier.
I had no
fucking all geeks should just live in Brussels, apparently.
I had no idea that would happen when I moved here. But
then we wouldn't have FOMO. Anyway, sorry.
Go on. It's all good. So today, we are going to, now that we started out with Brussels, we are going to bounce right back across the pond. Because you wonderful people... have your Turkey Day coming up. We are going to look at one particular movie, but really put it in the context of one a gentleman, a writer and a director by the name of WD Richter, who has a movie that he wrote that was Jodie Foster's second directorial effort, called Home for the Holidays, which is one of the few Thanksgiving movies, and I think it's the best Thanksgiving movie for feels and reasons we'll get into later. Yes, you Planes, Trains, and Automobile people, sit down. I'm sorry. I think it's better. Not that I don't like Planes and Trains, et cetera, it's fine. But anyway, before we did that, we go into our first segment always, which is what we call What's Elevating Our Genre, where we talk about what's making us happy and moving and grooving in the smart geeky world. Stuff. I started last week. Dom, over to you, brother. What's elevating your genre this week?
Oh, okay. Well, elevating my genre this week is... This segues out of last week's episode, actually.
Okay.
Well, I was poking around for about Akira stuff. Found out there was another movie that came out this year called Akira.
Do you want to guess where it's from? No, I saw it because I poked... When I was poking around, it's Indian. It's India movie, yeah? It's out of India?
Yes. You saw the same thing.
I did see the same thing, I think. Yeah, okay, yeah. Okay. Please tell people about it.
Did you see any bit of it?
I didn't even see the trailer. No, I forgot to check it out.
Oh, okay. Well, let's just say I found a way to see some of it. Let's just say that. Mm-hmm. and it's pretty cool. I haven't yet finished the whole movie yet. It's very long, and also, again, I'm not someone who knows a lot about Indian Hollywood films and Indian Bollywood films, mm-hmm. whatever. But I'm trying to know more about Indian films because it's this whole thing. Yeah, I've only seen a few of them.
Yeah, same here.
I don't know whether it's acceptable to interchange Indian film and Bollywood, but definitely I'm interested in the kind of mm-hmm. like more the mass entertainment ones because they're mm-hmm. this totally different idiom. They've got musicals, they're very long.
Yeah.
they have weird government public service announcements during the movie. Anyway, sorry. That's the general. I'm off track. But the cool thing, one cool thing is Akira, the Indian movie which came out this year, is very much a it's a female-led revenge story. It's a sort of female empowerment battle story. And it's very stirring. This young woman comes to the aid of some of her friend who is attacked by some punks who throw acid in her face. Horrifically scarring her forever. And in the movie sort of way, she learns martial arts and becomes
And her name is Akira.
And that's a fascinating. That's another cool thing. This language is a cool thing. Like some words just pop up in different languages independent of each other. And Akira is apparently an Indian woman's name. It's also a Japanese name. This happens a lot.
From my understanding, it's a very common Japanese name as well, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm sure it's basically the same word. I'm sure the exact phonology, there's different sounds. And I'm not sure, I was once told that the proper Japanese pronunciation is Akira.
Akira, right.
But I could be wrong on that too. Anyway, but the point is this might happen a lot with female names for some reason. It's for example, also in Japanese, they have the name Naomi, and Naomi is also, Western or Hebrew name, or I'm not sure what the... Mm-hmm. But the point is they came out independently of each other, and they were just like, oh, those sound nice together.
Yes, those sound phonemes so anyway, together. Yeah, right.
But... So, leading to the point, which is cool, which is that this Indian Akira movie has nothing to do with the Japanese Akira.
Yeah.
Has nothing to do with it, but it's a cool story in its own right.
Yeah, right.
It's very much in the context of India, where one would really hope for a tough vigilante woman to, serve and protect their, their... Cool. Struggle with patriarchy there. Yeah. So anyway, and I'm half hoping that that whoever's in charge of making the Akira remake in their ignorance will just stumble upon this movie and remake that one by accident.
Remake the fucking Indian movie.
They don't fucking know shit.
So they don't fucking cast Leonardo DiCaprio as Tetsuo or some bullshit.
Right, and don't cast him as the Indian woman either. Anyway,
that's gonna be good. That's cool.
Indian movies. Trying to know more about them. They're cool.
What's elevating my genre this week? I am sort of gearing up for Joanne, of course, and I've been slamming inspiration after inspiration into my head to sort of, because that's how I, to help me visualize what I like to sort of, you know, get a decent amount of stimuli in my head the same way. And for some reason I got it in my head, I needed to watch a Hitchcock movie. And I, liberated a Hitchcock, DVD, collection from the acting school that I was teaching at that closed down, on the way out the door. Nobody didn't know what they was going to do with them. So I was like, I will be a good home for this. In there, instead of watching like a classic, I got sort of attracted to The Trouble with Harry. I don't know. Have you ever seen this one?
Never seen The Trouble with Harry, though.
It's Hitchcock's comedy. And a terrible choice for what I was trying to do. But it turns out a brilliant, fun little piece, because it's this crazy... it's based on a British stage play, but adapted by Americans. And, of course, Hitchcock is British. And acted by Americans, but still filtered through Hitchcock's lens and Britishness. And it's deeply bizarre in terms of what it is. It's really fucking funny, number one. It's this deeply, it's a very black comedy, literally about a bunch of people who have to deal with a dead Harry. The trouble with Harry is that he's fucking dead. And all these people.
It's already funny. Yeah,
exactly.
In an awful sort of way.
Oh, this sort of way. Right. I'm sorry. Trouble Harry originally isn't a stage play. It's a novel or a short story. One of those two. I can't remember which that Hitchcock read and got obsessed with and wanted to do. And dig this. It's Shirley MacLaine's film debut.
Bizarrely,
playing this incredibly deadpan ingenue character who was married to Harry, but she's super deadpan the whole time, and super redhead and super weird, and then has this incredibly that wonderful late 50s early 60s under the radar sexual conversation with the leading man, all about sex, but they can't say the word sex, and it's very clever the way they get around it all, and it's just kind of sexy and funny. And then the rest of the movie's funny because they just keep burying this dead guy and having to dig him back up like over the course of one day. Richard Forsythe plays Robert Forsythe, I think, plays the leading man character. It's just really funny. It's fucking funny. Hitchcock is obnoxious. He's just a fucking such a genius filmmaker that he can just do whatever the fuck he wants, asshole.
Almost obnoxiously so.
And just fucking knock it out of the park every goddamn time. So, and again, if you're a fan of British humor, it's this crazy British humor put through this weird, strained through American filmmaking, because Hitchcock is definitely an American filmmaker, but he's whatever. He's got the British sensibilities for sure.
Yeah.
And it's Americans saying this dialogue that clearly should be coming out of these British mouths.
Right.
But it works because the casting, because Hitch is also a genius at casting. It works. It's just, I don't know, it might have been the headspace I was in because I had zero idea of what to expect. But it's super
that
elevated.
That sounds absolutely delightful, I would say.
Delightful is a good word for
it. And also, that's a big nut to crack that we talk about, like British humor coming over to America by American people.
Yeah.
Typically, like in Hitchhiker's Guide is a really good example of where that doesn't work really well.
Right, for you. Or, you definitely didn't enjoy that.
Or for me, it didn't work as well as it should. So I love that idea because I do love British humor.
Yeah, I'd recommend it if you can get your hands on it. It's
awesome.
It's a riot. I found it delightful. So anyway, get a chance to get your hands on Trouble with Harry. I know it's not sort of surprising. It's a Hitchcock film. Oh my God, it's good. But it's obviously a lesser known piece. And it's Hitchcock's, as far as I know, only comedy. So it's definitely a straight up comedy. But of course, it's a black comedy about death. So shock, surprise. If you don't count some of Hitchcock's Alfred Hitchcock Presents, which are also kind of, there's a few dark comedies in that television series. But anyway, Trouble with Harry. So there you go. All right. So let's get into it, man. We are talking about the more I dig, the stranger this dude's career gets, the strange career of WD Richter, who for, I think Dom and I will forever be an immortal, if nothing else, just for adapting, getting the adaptation by credit for Big Trouble in Little China, and then also directing Buckaroo Banzai and His Adventures Across the Eighth Dimension to what I would
consider... Now, wait, when you... Mm-hmm. When you say adapting, what is the credit there?
That's his credit. I'll get into what that means in a second.
Okay.
But that's his exact credit. That. It's technically adapted by WD Richter.
Okay.
And I'll tell you the history behind that. And he directs The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai. He does not write that, but he directs it. Or written by a dude named Earl Mac Roush, who I will get into a little bit as well. Those two movies, for me, are two of the most singular films, not just of the 80s, but for my money, of all time. They have sensibilities that are just their own thing, and they are mad crazy genius for a variety of reasons, which again we'll get into, and we'll try not to retread the area we had within the John Carpenter and Big Trouble in Little China stuff. But all right, let me set this dude up, because dude, I know you don't know this and I didn't know this, this is a fucking bizarre career this guy has, and technically he's still upright and kicking around, and his last movie, Stealth, which I did not see, was written by him, dropped in 2005 or 6 or whatever. Anyway, let's put this in order. All right, dig this. So, WD Richter, real guy. You were asking if that was like a pseudonym. Not a pseudonym. That's the dude's name.
I still think that Earl Merrick Roush is his Tyler Durden. I don't think that guy exists. I think he's an alternate split-off personality of him.
Earl Mac Roush has got his own fucking bizarre career path, which I will talk about as well.
Maybe
they're the same person, because they always...
One of them is a doppelganger or something. It just can't be... There's something fishy about the whole thing to me. But anyway,
it's entirely possible, because it is W.D. Richter, which is three syllables, and Earl Mac Roush is three syllables. So I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. But and here's the weirdness. They both are Dartmouth grads, so it's a Dartmouth conspiracy. Whatever. Apparently.
One is a psychic projection of the other. I just don't know which is which.
That may be possible.
But
Richter gets spit out of Dartmouth like 3 years before this Earl Mac Roush guy does. Anyway, he goes into Hollywood. Dig the list of people this guy has fucking written for or worked with. All right. He starts with a movie called Slither. Never seen it. Starring James Caan in the 60s when Caan is a deal. Then he does this movie called Pepper. Also never seen it. Starring fucking Michael Caine, Natalie Wood. And he adapts. And this is where he starts adapting. Pepper is an adaptation. Then he does fucking Nickelodeon, directed by Peter Bogdanovich at the height of his power, starring Ryan O'Neal, Tatum O'Neal, and a little dude named Burt Reynolds in a time where he's the highest paid star in Hollywood. Okay? Then he goes on to do the fucking adaptation and remake of The Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Now, feel how you feel about that movie. A lot of people...
Is that the one with Donald Sutherland in it?
Yes, sir, man. And for people in podcast land, they can't see me, is the big wide-eyed and dropped mouth thing that they all do when they turn, right? Which is a wonderful addition to that movie. Again, I don't know if that's written in the screenplay or whatever, but it's fucking Invasion of the Body Snatchers with Donald Sutherland, okay? The remake. Right. And it's not a bad remake. I mean, again, yes, some people really hate it because of the 70s vibe, but I think if you go back, you'll find it's a pretty creepy fucking movie. And a damn fine updating of Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Then he fucking adapts Frank Langella's Dracula, which is a hidden gem. If you haven't seen it, the 70s Dracula, which was actually based on a Broadway restaging of the Dracula adaptation by, I'm forgetting the playwright's name now. But anyway, this is when Frank Langella is a young, incredibly hot dude, and that movie is sexy as all get out. It's a fantastic, if you've never seen it, it's great.
I haven't.
It's Langella's Dracula. Frank Langella is playing Dracula in it. And the reason they made it is because Frank Langella kicked all sorts of ass in the Broadway restaging of it. And they made it into a film. And it's very 70s. And Dracula has a fucking popped collar and an open shirt, you know, a couple open buttons. I mean, it's 70s, but it's kind of sexy.
I feel I did see this
I think
one.
You did see it, yeah. Anyway, most people know it for the swimming pool scene, so I don't know, whatever. If you guys know what that means, then you go check it out. Anyway, but fucking W.D. Richter does the adaptation from the Broadway play to the screenplay. Then he does this movie, I've never heard of it, called All Night Long, but dig the fucking cast. Gene Hackman, Barbara Streisand, and Diane Ladd. Three Academy Award winners or nominees, at least, in that bunch. Then the motherfucker goes on and does Brubaker. Writes Brubaker, starring Robert Redford. Then he does some fucking throwaway movie called Hard Feelings, starring nobody. Okay? Then he's got so much cred because most of those, again, a lot, you might not have heard a lot of those movies, but though he's working with all the A-list heavy hitters of that time period, of the late 70s. So he gets a chance to sort of jump up to jump in, and he forms a production company. And at this point, apparently he runs into Earl MacRouche, writes a novel right out of Dartmouth that somehow finds its way to WD Richter that he adores, which is apparently this crazy piece of work that he adores. And he convinces Earl MacRouche to come out to Hollywood and see if they can crack, he can get him some work. And they form a production company, and they immediately start working on Buckaroo Banzai. I'm going to sidebar that just for a second, because Earl MacRouche, in the meantime, manages to fucking work on New York, New York, the Martin Scorsese fucking musical.
Oh, yeah, that movie.
He writes that fucking thing. Earl MacRouche, the guy that writes Buckaroo Banzai, writes goddamn New York, New York. I'm telling you, this web is so bizarre and so weird. You can't make this shit up. Because from New York, New York, there's a couple other things that he works on, Earl MacRouche, that is. And then they fucking do, W.D. Richter has enough power, and he fucking directs Buckaroo Banzai. That's the thing they do together. Because Earl MacRouche then apparently sits down, and W.D. Richter spend like 3 years creating this incredible expanded universe, which, again, remember, this is like 1986. This doesn't happen yet, right? This all comes out of Earl MacRouche's head. And W.D. Richter hammering it out. And they fucking come up with Buckaroo Banzai. And they form this production company to make Buckaroo Banzai. Which they do. All right? Okay. We're not going to unpack Buckaroo Banzai because maybe that maybe deserves its own podcast. We are? Well, we'll talk a little bit about it, I guess. Because
I was told there would be Buckaroo Banzai.
Oh, okay, all right. There'll be some Buckaroo Banzaiing. All right, let me just try to finish this timeline before we get sidetracked. So he directs Buckaroo Banzai, written by Earl MacRouche. And then the very next thing this motherfucker does is adapts Big Trouble in Little China. I'm going to skip over that moment as well. We're going to come back to that. Okay, but remember, Big Trouble in Little China. Now he's working with John Carpenter and Kurt Russell. Now, both of those, Kurt Russell's star is a little faded. John Carpenter's star is a little faded at that point. Then he directs this piece of shit that I'm watching right now called Late for Dinner, which I don't even understand what happened here or why he decided he needed to do that. And then his directing career is over. And then he writes Needful Things for Stephen King. Then his genius comes, adapts Needful Things. Notice he's in this adapting realm. Then he adapts Needful Things for Stephen King, which most people credit as one of the worst Stephen King movies of all time. But there you go. But then he fucking adapts, because it's an adaptation, this magical little piece called Home for the Holidays, which again gets directed by Jodie Foster, stars Robert Downey Jr., Holly Hunter, David Strathern, a very young Dylan McDermott, whatever, and then just goes silent until somehow magically he reappears in 2005 for Stealth. I didn't even see it. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, it's an artificially intelligent stealth bomber that is basically Skynetting its way around, and Jamie Foxx has to scuttle the stealth bomber. I don't know. I'll eventually watch it just because I'm a completionist. So... And this is where this guy's career has sort of is ended up. I don't know what he's doing. I'm assuming he lives in fucking Connecticut. I've read some stories about... Of course he lives in Connecticut, right. I've read some stories that between, like, you know, Big Trouble in Little China and sort of Home for the Holidays and whatever... between Home for the Holidays and Stealth, which is a 10-year jump, by the way, he was still getting writing work. It's just none of it was getting made. And for those that don't understand the film business, that happens an awful lot for working screenwriters. They may do some rewrites on the down low where they're just getting paid a weekly to come in and fix stuff, or they, you know, whatever. Some producer hires them to write a script that just never gets made, and that happens quite frequently. So it's entirely possible between 2005 and now he's worked on 18 scripts that we just don't know about. But whatever, he's gone silent as far as I know. Okay. So...
He made two of the best things ever. Maybe three.
Yes, maybe two or three of the best things ever. So let's sort of go backwards now. And let's sort of take this in order. So again, it goes, directs Buckaroo Banzai and adapts Big Trouble in Little China. So, Buckaroo Banzai is... I've talked too much. You tell me, what is Buckaroo Banzai for you, brother? You jump in here. Talk to me.
Buckaroo Banzai is a great film of the 80s. And, by the way, it was a busy week. I didn't get to rewatch or watch everything I was supposed to. So I'm going completely from recall here.
Oh, shit.
Of Buckaroo Banzai. Everything I say about Buckaroo Banzai is just stuff in my head from having seen it 100 times.
This actually might be better.
So if I get it wrong, I get it wrong. But I'm pretty sure I'm going to get most of it because I've seen that shit 100 times.
Yeah, man. Talk about it. Throw it down.
It's a crazy fusion movie. As you said, expanded universe. You know, maybe it was was supposed to be part of a gigantic 10-part series and radio serial and novel and comic book. And, you know, clearly they had a whole empire planned.
Yep.
It is so, like, one of the most ironic movies ever made because it's so special and good, it actually was, you know, doomed to fail. Like, there's no way.
Yes.
You know, and it's the kind of thing that they say kills careers. It didn't kill his career, but, you know, it's the kind of thing where people go, we're not sure we want you to direct that second movie. That movie we thought you were going to direct, we're not sure we want you to do that anymore. It's the movie that does that to a person, even though it's just so good. Basically, it's a science fiction story about this guy named Buckaroo Banzai who invents a jet car that can sort of warp through space, and he accidentally releases some aliens who are trapped in another dimension who come and, you know, they're try to do some bad stuff, but fortunately meets up with the good aliens. And, oh, by the way, the guy's also a brain surgeon and has a rock band.
Yes.
And that's just, like, part of it. That's just, like, 2 minutes.
And it's played by Peter Weller, right?
It's played by Peter Weller, yeah.
Yes, who... is and also dig this cast, people, if you don't know. Again, just like who the fuck this guy works with? Peter Weller, John Lithgow, Jeff Goldblum, fucking Clancy Brown is in that movie. The Kurgan, for people who don't know who Clancy Brown is, and fuck you if you don't know who Clancy Brown is, by the way. One of the workingest actors in Hollywood. Clancy Brown, Ellen Barkin.
Ellen Barkin.
Ellen Barkin and Jeff Goldblum were literally nobody. Who else am I missing? Christopher Lloyd, Dan Hedaya, fucking crazy top to bottom.
That's the crazy aliens who all are named John including Warfin, John Big Booty, and John Warfin.
John Big Booty, John
More
Warfin,
power John, to him.
John Smallberries. Oh, God. Funny.
Yeah. And I want to add, and this is part of the reason I want to talk about Buckaroo Banzai so much, and I don't know if we'll get into it with the... if we talk about Big Trouble in Little China, it's one of those cultural fusion movies. Buckaroo Banzai is supposed to be a half Asian, half white person, and against the type, I looked up his character background. I don't know if you did. The fictional character, by the way, the hero.
Yeah,
their fictional background is he had a Japanese father and I believe a Scottish mother.
Right.
And Peter Weller totally pulls off that person who could be of mixed race, not because he is, I don't know if he is, but he does subtle things. He has that sort of a little distance, a little not of the world, and he does it great.
Yeah, and he also does, they do smart things with his hair. I know this sounds crazy, but they do smart things with his hair to give him a little extra quality. Now, Peter Weller, especially young Peter Weller, also has a certain kind of like, I don't know, interesting face too, which is a little exotic. But they do very smart things with his hair to sort of subtly hint that he's got a certain, that he may come from a certain background.
Yeah. Totally. Totally. And it's thought out.
It's thought out.
And that's what I like about him. He's clearly interested in doing this Asian fusion thing. I don't know what his Asian interest is, but he does those things in Big Trouble in Little China as well. And, you know, you gotta... Like I'm always looking for ways that cross-cultural art can be, you know, uplifting as opposed to depressing and racist. And we have to look at good examples of things.
Yes.
I don't care if he's Asian. He doesn't have to be. You don't just like you do not have to be white to, you know, have some white privilegey things.
Yeah.
You also don't have to be Asian to make a really good piece of Asian American art. It's just usually you don't.
Right.
Because people suck.
And also, I mean, let's again, you might not have seen it in a while, so you might not remember this. The good aliens are literally Rastafarian aliens, right? Are literally black dudes who come to the planet to save us from, no joke, redneck aliens, right? Like, the bad aliens are literally have rednecks. Like, they're redneck aliens, even though John Lithgow was doing this absurd Italian Mussolini impression, which is incredibly funny.
Some sort of Euro villain at the top of... Yep. Them. Yeah.
Right. And we are saved by Rastafarians. Let's be very clear about
that. That is delightful. Mm-hmm. That is one of the great things. Buckaroo Banzai and his rock band team up with the Rastafarian aliens to try to save the world from the redhead screaming obnoxiously named aliens.
So great.
Who are so gross. And and again, a little background of the things that I looked up, like apparently in the director's cut, his mom was played by Jamie Lee Curtis, which never made it to the final cut. And isn't that great? Because, by the way, somehow it also, you know, branched into today's Jamie Lee Curtis's birthday. So happy birthday, Jamie Lee Curtis.
Well, look at us. So throwing the Thanksgiving thing. We'll get there with Thanksgiving with a little Home for the Holidays. We get Jamie Lee Curtis's birthday. Good drop, brother.
I mean, you know, remember Halloween? And Jamie Lee Curtis has elevated some genres along the way.
No doubt.
We might want to talk about Jamie Lee Curtis.
We might need to throw Jamie Lee. We might need to do a podcast
on
Jamie.
She's done a few genre elevating things. I don't know where it's going with this except to say, some of that that Buckaroo Banzai movie is so fucking great.
It's
so
great. I mean, it's I did a geek movie night here recently, like in the last 2 months or whatever, and that's the movie I happened to show because I happened to run across the DVD for sale for like $2 here somewhere, and I showed it to people and like people's brains melted here, like they hadn't heard of it, they didn't know what it was, and it's also very much like Big Trouble in Little China. It is such an 80s movie, but it is so, at the same time, so forward-thinking and so far ahead of its time.
Oh, it's so
it's
far.
Like, if that movie had dropped in 2008, and they didn't change a frame outside of just sort of, you know, the various technology stuff, like, it would have actually fit. Like, it would have been
fine. It might have.
It also probably would have been just as ignored, I don't know. But, like... just like Big Trouble in Little China, it is so ahead of its time that it's crazy pants. But at the same time, has such a design element that is completely of the moment, completely of the 1980s.
Yeah.
Which is also this weird connecting tissue between Big Trouble in Little China and fucking and Buckaroo Banzai. Now, this does not extend to Home for the Holidays, but the Holidays has a certain of its time periodness to it as well. So I don't know. WD Richter does seem to have this ability to, like, I don't know, whatever, be of the present moment, whatever that happens to be. Which is, I don't know, is an interesting quality to have. So can't recommend Buckaroo Banzai highly enough. The other thing I'd recommend is that there's a, because Kevin Smith is a huge, whatever you feel about Kevin Smith, is a gigundous Buckaroo Banzai fan and is apparently trying to pull off a Netflix or an Amazon Prime TV show based on it. But they're stuck in some serious rights issues because Earl Mac Roush, apparently, the people who own...
Does not exist.
No, he exists.
He's a psychic projection.
The psychic projection of WD Richter named Earl Mac Roush. when they signed over the rights to the movie, didn't sign over all of the extended universe rights, and there's a big kerfuffle about the rights issues. So anyway, so apparently W.D. Richter and Earl Mac Roush are completely in conflict with whichever entity, I think it's MGM now, that owns the rights.
Wow.
And Kevin Smith is trying to detangle all that and whatever. Anywho, there is a Kevin Smith at a New York Film Festival, apparently in 2011, he did a showing. He did a showing of Buckaroo Banzai and got fucking John Lithgow and Peter Weller to come on stage. And it's an hour and 20-minute Q&A that you can find on YouTube and watch. And I highly recommend it. It's great to hear them talk about it.
Kevin Smith is not a visionary.
He's not a visionary. I didn't say he was a visionary. Whoa.
No, I'm okay. Complaining. I'm complaining of my own self.
He may not be a visionary.
Opposing anything you said.
He may not be anything.
He's,
the one thing
he's
you
not the guy who's gonna do that. He is genre, but
saying.
He doesn't really elevate it.
I see what you're saying. You're talking about as a creator. Yeah, no, I don't know exactly. Yeah, I don't know if he would be able to elevate it. But I would trust him to at least keep it at the weird fervent level that it was at.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if he could improve upon it.
He could probably do that.
I think he could do that. I would trust him to do that. But anyway, yes. No, but Kevin Smith is definitely not a visionary. Anywho, we could talk about whatever, Kevin Smith some other day. Or we could save that for issues, maybe. Kevin Smith and possibly...
Well, just on the level that Buckaroo Banzai, again, and Big Trouble in Little China, and Strangely Home for the Holidays are all visionary.
They are. They are. That's true. Absolutely.
And I just want to have one more thing. By the way, I like that we're doing a podcast about a guy I don't even know what he looks like.
Yeah, you know, same here.
This is kind of nice. Usually we're talking about some known quantity actor, somebody we know by face. But, you know, as a writer guy, I primarily like to think that, you know, the bottom line is your work stands for what it is. You know, your work is your face. It should be. Bottom line, all other shit aside, your work should be your face. It should not matter what you look like or who you're connected to. So I think, and his work absolutely has touched us in so many ways, and I don't know what he looks like. So this is kind of a nice change. I have no idea. And I don't care is the point. It is not significant. The significant thing is he created that work.
Yep. Absolutely.
Wow.
It's cool, man. And that's the other reason why I'm trying to, you know, get his name out there.
That's why I think it's great.
Because again, both of us we love this guy's work, and both of us were like, that has to be a nom de plume. Like, this might be a fucking situation where it's an Alan Smithy thing. I mean, obviously Alan Smithy is bandied around. For those that don't know, Alan Smithy is as sort of a joke name that came out of Hollywood in the 80s and the 90s for people who pulled their name off a material and nobody wanted to take that spot. So they call it an Alan Smithy movie or whatever. And that became a joke. I don't think it's a thing anymore. But, you know, first, I'll admit... For like 5 minutes there, I was like, maybe WD Richter is one of these things. That's like, because it's such a weird name. But no, he's got
JD Salinger.
Could be maybe what his.
But yeah, that's why, because Hollywood has trained us to be suspicious of anyone who doesn't have a face, a headshot, a big presence, has made a lot of noise making a name for themselves, you know, as a personality. That's why this is a nice contrast, because we couldn't believe it. That's just some guy, and he's not like super famous and has his own line of clothes or whatever.
He's just
a guy who made the art.
He's just a guy that made the art, and maybe it was because he came up in the 70s when that was maybe as much of a thing for writers. And then his director, I mean, let's be honest, he's directed two things, one of which is a used to be a super deep cult cut. Buckaroo Banzai was not well known. And then this late for dinner thing, which I'm watching, seems to be a piece of garbage. and made in 1991.
But that's okay. That's what real artists do too. They make a good thing and then they make
a shitty thing. Yeah, totally fine. I have no problem with that. We'll talk about that. I'll talk about that in issues because there may be some accidental genius stuff going on here. I don't know. I want to attack that idea as an issue. But let's move forward. All right. So.
Yes.
Very quickly, and we certainly won't spend a lot of time on Big Trouble in Little China, because if you really want that stuff, go to the Big Trouble in Little, the John Carpenter Big Trouble in Little China podcast. There's plenty, over an hour's worth of material there between Dom and I. But we do want to stop here and say, so I do want to unpack this adaptation thing, because this is interesting.
What is that?
Yeah, so number one, so WD Richter gets known for adapting stuff, because pretty much after Slither, almost all of his stuff is adaptation. I don't think Nickelodeon is an adaptation. But everything I listed is some version of an adaptation, not an original material. I think he wrote, Brubaker is also a fucking adaptation. So he gets, and for those, again, that don't necessarily know the Hollywood thing, once you get known for doing a thing, you kind of get stuck in it. Now, being known as an adapter is pretty cool because Hollywood's dumb enough to not be like, oh, you only adapt one thing. But if you're just an adapter, obviously they threw this guy Dracula, the stage play for Dracula. They threw him Invasion of the Body Snatchers, which is a remake of a screenplay, which is of a short story. He gets to adapt a couple of short stories in here. He gets to adapt a novel, blah, blah, blah. So it seems like he gets or at least the stuff that's getting made he's getting hired for these adaptations. So real quick, production history of Big Trouble in Little China. Big Trouble in Little China is actually written by two dudes named Gary Goldman and David Z. Weinstein. And as far as I can tell, that is not Mr. Z. Weinstein here. Has no relation to the Weinsteins, if you know who they are from Miramax and Bob and whatever, the lords, one of the Prince Royals of Hollywood, okay? He's not of that link. He just happens to share the name. So these dude, Gary Goldman and David Z. Weinstein, the only reason I can track this down is because they made a huge stink about this in 1986. So, in 1986, Gary Goldman and David Z. Weinstein together sell a thing called Big Trouble in Little China, sell a script. options, get their script option called Big Trouble in Little China, which apparently, originally I was, the geek ether was a straight up Western. This is not true. What apparently it is, according to this LA Times article I found, was Big Trouble in Little China was a Western that was set in San Francisco Chinatown, but it was still in the West and still actually took them, was about Chinese black magic that took them underground. But the hero was apparently a straight up Western hero, not named Jack Burton. There was actually a completely different name. Which you can find in the, I'll link the article. I'll link the LA Times article from 86.
It sounds not unlike Greg Pak's comic book, but
yeah, exactly right. Yeah, right. Greg Pak's his not Deadwood. What's he calling it?
It's, Kingsway West. Alternate Old West history centered around
type of thing, which is surprising to me.
So yeah, go on.
Which is surprising to me because again, the geekosphere was like, you know, Richter created this whole thing. So according to WD Richter, who was quoted in this fucking article, by the way, as calling, he was brought on as a rewriter, but apparently Gary Goldman and David Z. Weinstein were not told, which is common if your shit gets optioned. Sometimes you get optioned and people talk to you, or sometimes your shit gets optioned and you just cut out of the whole, you're cut out of the whole process. So apparently they were cut out of the whole process. Now, W.D. Richter, remember, is coming off of Buckaroo Banzai, but before Buckaroo Banzai as an adapter, he's got a pretty long list of decent credits. So apparently he was given carte blanche, and literally a quote in this article is, the script was garbage. Okay? Quote, unquote. So
he adapted garbage. Okay, good.
So that was his take on it. But, okay. I mean, it's still San Francisco Chinatown. They still do go underground. The Chinese black magic stuff is there. So there's something there. Now, apparently, the studio was going to go ahead and just give him screenplay credit. But somehow it got back to, and I can't remember now how, it gets back to Gary Goldman and David Z. Weinstein that this is, that the their movie has gone into production and has been completed. But name is not on it anymore. Now, somehow, I guess they were WGA folks and they immediately took it to arbitration. I am not going to unpack WGA arbitration for people. If you're curious, fucking
I'll fall asleep. Interested in that.
I'll try to link it, maybe. But basically, all you need to know, ladies and gentlemen, is that if, as a writer, and you have a WGA registered script, and you're a member of the WGA Writers Guild of America, and you think your name has been taken off the thing, and people or whatever, you can submit an arbitration thing. Now, that arbitration thing, basically, what happens is your script goes into arbitration, and people look at it. That's it. That's all I'm saying. And they will allocate. They will allocate. Screen by credit, written by credit, whatever, credits, right? Let's be very clear. I have almost never, outside of Big Trouble in Little China, seen adapted by ever as a title. For some reason, this arbitration, it gets kicked out, and Richter ends up getting adapted by, because apparently, according to Gary Goldman and David C. Weinstein, none of their dialogue remains. But some of the structure apparently does, which is the Chinese black magic and them going underground. Again, for those who don't know, in Big Trouble in Little China, there's a sequence where they have to go underground to attack David Lopan's headquarters. So, weirdly enough, out of this arbitration comes, Richter gets adapted by, but apparently has utterly rewritten the dialogue, which is a key thing, because the dialogue in Big Trouble in Little China is stellar, fantastic, and clearly... If you've rewritten all of Jack Burton and changes the name of Jack Burton, by the way, changes the name of the lead to Jack Burton. Jack Burton clearly is a creation of W.D. Richter, right? Wherever these original two guys were headed with that character, obviously Richter has created something very, very special in Jack Burton, which for those that don't know, one more time, someone shoot me in the face, is this wonderful critique of the male action hero, specifically filtered through the lens of John Wayne.
John Wayne, and a lot
of John Wayne, and then Kurt Russell layers on a little bit of Clint Eastwood if you know what to fucking look for. He's a fantastic critique of male action heroes. So that is the story of, and if you are interested in Gary Goldman and David Z. Weinstein, which just because, hey, I'm curious too, Gary Goldman goes on to write fucking Total Recall, Navy SEALs, and Next, and then somehow manages to weasel his way into being an executive producer on Minority Report, Spielberg's Minority Report. Super bizarre oeuvre for this guy as well. Super weird career. And then the only other credit he gets after that is the Total Recall remake as just, like, having written Total Recall.
Mm.
David Z. Weinstein then fucking disappears off the face of the earth and does nothing. So, I don't know. I swear
David
to God,
Z. Weinstein was a psychic projection of Gary Goldman. Can we just say that?
That's what's happening.
I'm tired of all these alternate,
all these fucking alternate people running around.
Alternate identities.
I'm just saying, okay. This is the weird, look, Hollywood credits are deeply weird in general, but I honestly feel like we've stumbled into this bizarre web between WD Richter, Earl MacRouch, Gary Goldman, and this David Z. Weinstein characters. They have some of the most bizarre, incredibly geeky, working with some of the most major talents you've ever heard of in your life, and you've never heard of any of these guys. It's very, I don't know, I feel like I'm in some kind of weird upside down land tracing all this shit together. But anyway.
It's a fascinating story. I didn't know that whole thing.
I didn't either.
But it makes total sense to me, and now I have a lot of questions about it.
Yes.
I'll drop the first question. The elephant in the room for me is, did Gary Goldman and Weinstein also write Showdown in Little Tokyo?
No, they did not. I don't know who the writers of that piece of shit are, but they did not have anything to do with that.
This makes a lot of sense to me now, because I could see how this played out very easily. I don't know if you thought about it with this layer, but yeah, it probably could have been a Western set in the past, and it probably was a shitty movie. I'm sure it was a shitty script.
Might have been.
Because the framework of Big Trouble in China is a pretty basic hero story, and as we know, it achieves its effect by subverting existing stereotypes,
exactly.
Or it could have just been that movie of Showdown in Little Tokyo, which just had the existing stereotypes,
just happened to be so, set in the West, right?
It makes, again, sometimes great art comes out of restrictions or, a conversation, or whatever you want to call it, between opposing forces, even debilitating forces. And I can totally see someone took, like, the B-movie Western that Big Trouble in Little China sounds like it should be, because it kind of sounds, that's the title sounds like it's a B-movie.
Mm-hmm.
And someone was like, well, let's upend this completely.
Well, clearly, that's what Richter had done.
And he did it.
Done. Yeah, yeah.
I'm sure he did that.
Yeah, yeah.
Not,
Back at his oeuvre, though, like, where does this fucking come from, man? Like,
yeah.
I mean, I get Dracula's a little subversive. Again, it's sort of a sexy take on a whatever. Invasion of the Body Snatchers is certainly elevated and smart, but again, the source material is really smart, right? Like, we could maybe credit that with Richter we can't, because if you haven't read the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers short story, fucking do it. It's great.
Okay,
source material is fantastic. It's really, it's beautiful. It's a really incredibly well written story, and it's one of the few properties that every time it gets adapted, it's solid. Even the is that 90s? Is there a late 90s adaptation of it as well? Which is
I think it was a Nicole Kidman one that they just called The Invasion.
The Invasion or whatever. That one even is passable. I don't even remember it being good, but whatever. Anyway, so outside of Buckaroo Banzai, and again, that makes some sense to me because Earl MacRouch, who sounds like, again, if you listen to this interview with Lithgow and Smith and Peter Weller, Earl MacRouch sounds like a hell of a character. So I understand why Richter and him getting together sort of, that may have like just shook something loose in Richter's brain for that.
Oh, I think they're very much of a piece.
Yeah. And then
Banzai and Big Troll, that makes sense to me.
So that would make sense. Like, if he's dragging a little Earl MacRouch over into, or whatever, Buckaroo Banzai into Big Trouble in Little China, because let's admit, like, all bets are off in Buckaroo Banzai, right? Like, there's, when we say it's a genre mashup, it's sci-fi, it's comedy, it's a bit fantasy. It's got a bit of a Western feel to it. It's an action movie. It's a little bit of everything. For him to
a little bit of music, a little bit of love story.
Music, yeah, love story, absolutely. Right. It's nuts. It's nuts. So if he goes then takes that energy into Big Trouble and gets this, let's be honest. I mean, I like the concept of whatever they wrote, like a Western that takes place in Chinatown that goes into Chinese
magic. Yeah.
It's kind of a cool idea. So if he sees that and then he just is like, yeah, the dialogue sucks, and he shakes the fucking shit out of it and restructures it and has all the Buckaroo Banzai-ness stuff still in his brain, then I can see where Big Trouble sort of comes out, right? I don't know. So you said you had questions, plural. Is there another one that we can throw back? Or is that...
Well, yeah, no, that's... I do wonder where he gets his interests in Asian culture, but
that's a good question.
Because he clearly has a very good curious writer's understanding of Chinatown.
It might be this Earl Mac Rouse
and chat. Japanese stuff by Buckaroo Banzai, and maybe anyway.
Yeah, Buckaroo Banzai is interested in Japanese culture, and fucking Big Trouble Little China is interested in Chinese culture, and they do very well to play with both of those things. As discrete entities and not just the general wash of Asianness, right?
Right. Yes, and absolutely. And again, just, you know, I treasure both these movies. I do consider them related. And again, for the very, very simple, basic reason of identification. It was those movies I could watch, and they had some Asian characters, some Asian stuff that wasn't totally insulting. and then on top of that, they were fun movies. And I want to say again, Buckaroo Bonds. It's like we make it sound like this big deal, but it's such a funny and delightful movie. You know what I mean?
It's delightful.
It just has a tone of like lightheartedness that you're kind of like, oh yeah, this is totally happening. This is awesome.
And it's one of the movies. If some people feel weird about the Zucker Brothers, especially where they sort of end up, and I get that. But like, I mean, in their heyday when they're doing Airplane, like one of the great things about them is that the fucking screen is layered with jokes. Like, there's the primacy of the joke that's happening, whatever that is, whether that's visual or verbal. And then there's three other jokes going on in the frame that are purely visual or written in the background. And when the Zucker Brothers are doing that, it because they just have a philosophy of, like, they just have a scattergun of jokes.
Sure, sure.
Buckaroo Banzai has that too, but they're coming from where the Zucker Brothers, it's just like, literally, they're just like, okay, random shit, because random shit is funny.
Yeah.
Buckaroo Banzai is, all the jokes in the background are happening because they did the expanded universe work, and there's other weird shit, and then there's also weird primacy of jokes like, what's the watermelon for? I'll tell you later. Right? Like,
what is that about?
And it never gets resolved, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry.
Never gets
resolved. There's no spoilers there because it never gets resolved. Did you know this?
Wondered.
There's Earl Mac Rouse wrote his own adaptation of Buckaroo Banzai, which apparently, a novelization, which is out there in the world. Uh-huh. I never read it, so maybe the watermelon's explained in that. I don't know.
I'll tell you later.
I'll tell you later, right? It's anyway. Okay.
Anyway, okay. Sorry.
We have to stop with the big T and the Buckaroo B. I just made that shit up. I'm never saying it out loud again because that was horrible. Because I do not want to give short shrift to a movie that I fucking truly adore for completely opposite reasons. This fucking movie, Home for the Holidays. Okay. Turkey Day's coming for you guys. Enjoy. Please, 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 if you have not seen this movie, and probably the only way to catch it is either on iTunes or Amazon Prime, because I don't think it's on Netflix. At least, certainly, it's not on Belgian Netflix. It might not be on American Netflix either.
Yeah, I checked. It was not.
Yeah, it's not.
On Netflix.
So it'll be on. It's on iTunes, I'm pretty sure. Go check this out. Number one, again, like for the cast that I already told you, it's a young Robert Downey Jr.
Stunning cast.
Young Robert Downey Jr., who is in that weird gap period where he hasn't fallen into the massive drug use yet, but he's clearly pissed off at Hollywood and he's not really going to play the game yet. And this is a movie that Jodie Foster talked him into, and the part did it. And also Jodie Foster allowed him to do his improvisational magic on this. And you can tell that that's there. But what's amazing about this movie is because certain movies with Robert Downey Jr. from that time period can't hold up to that. Like, it's just a Robert Downey Jr. show. This movie and this script, that's just a piece of the delightfulness that is going on with this. And I'm going to unpack that in a second. So real quick, Home for the Holidays is just fairly simple story. Holly Hunter plays a sort of a mid-30s, early 40s lost soul, a single mother who gets fired from her job right before she has to go fly back to her hometown to have Thanksgiving with her family, which is always apparently always a trouble. A young Claire Danes plays her mother. I think it's Claire Danes' third role or second role in the movie. She's leaving her teenage daughter behind, who has just announced that she's going to have sex with her boyfriend for the first time as well, of course. And Holly Hunter goes home, and Robert Downey Jr. is her gay brother, but not closeted gay, but basically closeted gay brother. Well, at least in the hometown, closeted.
He hasn't had the talk with
the parents. The parents don't know, basically. The parents know, but don't know, kind of a thing. or at least the mom knows, the dad clearly doesn't. Right. And then there's an older sister who's played by, shit, I can't remember her name, she does a really good job, who is sort of the super straight-laced one that has stayed in the hometown where the brother and the sister have gone off and left. Now, and then this script that Richter, again, adapted from a short story, from a guy I forgot to write down, Chris Palmer or something like that. I will link that in the show notes. That's my bad. Short story guy.
They're all named Chris.
They're all named Chris. It's a Chris guy. That's all I know. Named Chris, but whatever. Who never goes on to another thing. Joke. This is another fucking WD Richter thing. Like, this guy who wrote this short story has nothing else. He doesn't produce another fucking book. It's a short story. As far as I can tell, he doesn't even write more short stories. It's like he disappears off the face of the planet after WD Richter makes him look like a fucking genius. So I don't know.
Right.
Whatever. So Jodie Foster gets involved, and this is what is the first thing that I think is the most important thing, one of the most important things about the film. Gets a 2-week rehearsal process with her main cast. There is something so wonderfully connected and ensemble-y about this movie that feels a little bit like stage work, even though it's a $20 million production, literally. But there is Holly Hunter and Robert Downey Jr. and Dylan McDermott, who plays a friend of Robert Downey Jr.'s that he brings to dinner. The chemistry and the and they get to overlap dialogue also, which is this thing. And again, it's kind of rare. This is a movie from, 95 maybe? 95.
Something like that.
It's a bit rare of a technique, even at that time. We don't have the sort of, you know, mockumentary sort of talky-talky over each other all the time. And it works to great effect in this movie. And these people just like, and these actors are just killing it from one moment to the next. So that's sort of the setup for Home for the Holidays. Now, I know you hadn't visited this movie in a while, or was this the first time you've ever seen it?
I'm not as familiar with it as you are, and but I agree with you completely. On my casual viewings, it does all that. It's a wonderful piece.
But
my questions are, because you are more familiar with it, is what even happens to the David Strathairn guy? What happens to him?
That's it. He gets David Strathairn, who is one of my favorite actors. He's fantastic and somewhat criminally underused, unless you like John Sayles movies. He's all over John Sayles movies. James Strathairn plays this sad sack Terziak, who is just another guy who hasn't left town that Holly Hunter's mom is trying to hook. They had a relationship back in the day, Holly Hunter's mom just sort of calls him over to try to sort of hook them up, and it's just this wonderful little heartbreaking scene between David Strathairn and Holly Hunter, where Holly Hunter's just like, it just wants nothing to do with him, and he is a sad sack, but there's something immensely charming because it's David Strathairn, and then he just, that's his scene, and he's out of the film. He doesn't come back because this movie is concerned with reality, right? Like, what happens when you actually return home? You know what I mean?
Right.
Which is great. No, he doesn't come back. He's just a fucking
sad. He really likes her. There's this very realistic kind of heart on the sleeve moment, and I, of course, I always feel for that guy. I feel for the for the awkward Kokuhaku guy, and not the suave guy, Dylan McDermott. You know, it's a beautifully played scene.
Gorgeous.
And do you think they were trying to do something subversive by giving it a stupid name? Is that's my other question? It sounds like a completely cookie cutter Hollywood stupid movie. Sounds like one. But it is not.
It's the opposite of
Ice Storm.
It's like the opposite of Big Trouble in Little China and Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai, which are just ridiculous names that sort of set up this B-movie tone that then Hollywood completely failed to capitalize on marketing the film properly. Also, if you go back and you watch the Home for the Holidays trailer, it misses the tone completely, which is
exactly, right.
Because they try to do exactly what the title implies, which is like, it's this home for the... Literally, I think it ends with that fucking voiceover... Home for the Holidays.
It just looks like one of those fucking stupid movies.
It's so dumb, and it's
that
not
have,
the
even
tone
have better
of this
titles
movie.
Than that. You know, at least they're like called like Christmas versus Shark or something. You know, or like Or like, yeah. We're all together in love at the holidays again. Nah, nah, nah.
Yeah.
And it looks like it has the scent of being that movie, and yet it's not. It's everything you just said. It's a wonderful ensemble piece about family and this and Robert Downey. And you know, I have mixed feelings of that guy, mm-hmm. but my baseline feeling is he's very good at his job. Whatever. Yes. Whenever he's in the movie, he's doing that job well, and he brings to that kind of closeted that that gay guy who has to come back to his family, and members of his family aren't comfortable with it, or have been keeping it as a secret, and negotiating all those landmines, and still being that sort of charming asshole that Robert Downey Jr. usually is.
Yeah,
it's. And very the fact touching.
That, and it doesn't, and it also, it doesn't resolve in some bullshit, like everybody accepts no. him way, right? It's like, the only thing you could say that's maybe a little cliche is that there is the big Thanksgiving dinner scene that falls apart and family secrets are revealed or whatever, but they're done mm-hmm. in such a goddamn good way. And also, the other thing you gotta mm-hmm. tip the hat to is, and apparently they took 2 weeks to film that one sequence. Thus the $20 million, somehow, if you're wondering how it got spent on this family drama comedy, that's where it got spent. Cause it looks like they went through like 70, must've gone through 70 fucking real baked right. turkeys. Scene also has two fucking turkeys in it, which is funny in and of itself, but.
And Steve Guttenberg's talking to one.
Talking like, the seriously. Whole time. He's great. Like, fucking Steve Guttenberg is in it as well.
Economic policy. It's so brilliant. Good. So
but after that perfect. Sequence, so there are family secrets that are revealed. And in any other movie,
right.
would have been handled in this goofy, shitty, cheesy way. That, but because it starts with the sort of family secret reveal of this maudlin thing that happens, oh, by the way, through Geraldine Chaplin, by the way, Charlie Chaplin's granddaughter. It's fucking great really? In this. Oh. Yes. Who plays the aunt. So this sort of maudlin thing happens that, you know, is cute and kind of funny and awkward and weird. That then descends into this really angry attack moment between the older sister and Robert Downey Jr. because of this really ridiculous moment that happens. But that is truly, clearly horrifying for this woman, right? Like something happens to her. I'm not gonna. She basically ends up with a turkey in her lap, and then, which is a ridiculous. And it's a perfect family moment where it's just like this is ridiculous, and then immediately it just because these people love hate each other so much and know exactly how to go for the jugular, immediately descends into this very family, very familial, just like attack, needling each other in this uncomfortable, really grounded way.
Yeah.
That ends with this, you know, that ends with her, the older sister, outing the older brother to everybody. And then she goes on this tear on him about, like, him, how embarrassing it is for him being gay and having married his partner, or at least had a ceremony, because obviously gay marriage is not legal at that time. But, and you don't get the normal Hollywood, then Robert Downey Jr. gets to turn around and tell her off. He just eats it and he just accepts it. Because in that moment, it's his older sister fucking telling him off, and it's a wonderful moment. And then we don't stay on them. We go to the what has actually happened to the mom from this result, and Holly Hunter and her have this fucking brilliant scene in a cupboard where they're eating and they're just talking about how everybody's growing up and moving on. And it's just it's just note perfect. Like for me, again. My family, this is not my family in general, but it's just the way my family talks to each other, right? And again, because my family is half Italian and my mom is 100% Italian, and we just get after each other in a way that like is deeply personal. And but the love is still underneath everything, but man, and then the older sister has a beautiful line at the end of the movie, which is like, talking to her younger sister, if I ran into you on the street and you gave me your phone number, I'd throw it away, right?
Oh man.
And that's exactly, I love my family, and maybe they're listening to this, but sometimes it's exactly how I feel that we would treat each other, right? Because I'm this I'm the Holly Hunter character, I'm the one that went away and has to come back, and I'm the weird
you're
animal
the weird
that has to be examined when I come in the door. And I'm also a pissed off animal that keeps coming, that comes back and needles them, because I lose my sense of empathy for them sometimes as well.
Yeah.
And this movie captures that.
Yeah.
in a way I've never seen repeated in any other Hollywood film, right? That is interesting. You know, there's some indie films that really examine family relationships, but this still allows you to sort of have the gloss of Jodie Foster and $20 million and all these named people, but it still gets it at the core, right? And again, like Big Trouble in Little China and Buckaroo Banzai, there's something at the core where they get something that is really fucking real and fucking juicy as shit.
Yeah. And it's super actually about Thanksgiving, right? It's actually about that kind of situation or Christmas or whatever they're doing. It's super about that holiday
thing. It's about Thanksgiving. It's about
But in a completely explorative way. And I get, I totally agree with that. And I was also like, and it's a conversation that a lot of families are having right now, maybe this year, you know, because when we talk, like no one's a bigot in the family. No one's an awful person.
Right.
They're all terribly human people. They're flawed people.
Right.
They have strong opinions. They have their little infights, as so many families do.
Yeah.
Without anyone having to be, you know, like you said, the Hollywood thing would be like, you know, the sister's an evil corporate lawyer or something, and you know, Robert Downey Jr. has to take her down or something. Or, but you know, it's much more subtler and much more real than that.
Absolutely.
And I also just want to add, you know, some love for Charles Durning, because
I
love the father guy, because, you know, just in a personal note, you know, my dad's also getting, he's up there in age, he's kind of becoming that kind of scattered, a little, you know, prioritizes eating and not really doing things in a coordinated way, and, you know, you just, and likes to sing, and is verging on inappropriate a lot of the time. But you know, is at his core adorable and the good man who raised us, and so fucking I just felt that a lot.
Yeah, the feels. I mean, the feels for me on that too. For me is it's deeply a movie that is deeply about staying and leaving, and what that means for parents and adult siblings, right? And there are so few movies about adult siblings and their relationship to the fucking adults that are still in their life, their parents. That is really interested in exploring that. The Savages does it a little bit, if you know that movie.
Good one.
There's a comedy that came out recently that I missed with Will Arnett and Amy Poehler, right? And I think they're a brother and sister team that are dealing with aging parents. I can't remember what that is. But The Savages is also a really damn fine movie.
Savages is great, yeah. I keep thinking of the list of movies that the Home for the Holidays shares shares a pack with, and none of them are called something like Home for the Holidays.
Yes, that's why I think that's true. Exactly.
I think of the Savages. I think the Ice Storm. I think of the Ice Storm. Do you know this movie called Lonesome Jim? A rather obscure indie that was directed by Steve Buscemi. Steve Buscemi has directed a couple very small scale indie movies.
Right.
And the second one I like is called Lonesome Jim, and I'm just gonna because it's a very similar story in which Casey Affleck plays a guy who's basically failed at everything in life and returns to his Midwestern town because
that's what you do.
Nothing worked out for him, basically. Yeah. And it's a simple story, and people can not like it because it's very sad sack kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But it reminded me a lot of this because, and again, to give some love for Holly Hunter, Holly Hunter's a class fucking act.
God damn, is she good in this? And she's...
I loved her since Broadcast News. I think a wonderful film. She's really classy and just so beautiful, just a beautiful woman.
And quirky and, as all fuck, but in a way that isn't like just quirky for random sake. Like Zoe Deschanel is what she is, but particularly her early work was just kind of quirk for bullshit's sake. As far as I was concerned, she's settled down now for my taste.
Yeah.
But Holly Hunter actually has a take on life. Do you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Right, and I was just trying to connect up, like, you know, because it gets overlooked in the light tone, but there's some part in Home for the Holidays where she's just kind of sums up where life is, and you're like, oh, you have nothing. Your life has been devastated. She just says something kind of real casual, and this is sort of what happens on some gym too. She just lost my job, don't have any money, kind of lost all my support system connections to life, and wow. I don't have a lot in this hand anymore. Which, you know, maybe as you grow older, sometimes you face those moments.
Absolutely, man. And it's just, and it's wonderful that it's all in the context of like coming home for Thanksgiving and having to face all that shit, right? Yeah. Like especially us artists sometimes, like just coming home and being like when the fucking aunt who you haven't seen in 8 years anyway or whatever, who you never gave a shit about, you know, sits you down and is like, how's the drama? And you know, all that's actually in her head is like, well, I haven't seen you on TV, so you must suck, right?
Yeah, like, right.
Or whatever. And you have to sit there and be like, it's fine.
Yeah.
I've been working really fucking hard, but you wouldn't understand it at all. So everything.
Yeah.
I want to die. Right.
Right, it's, totally.
And that this movie just gets that in spades on so many levels.
Yeah.
While allowing every single character to be their own actual character with an inner life. They all get a moment. They all get a chance to fucking be who they are in beautiful relationship to each other, which again, I think is not only just a testament to the script, but a testament to the directing. Again, I don't know if people realize how good a director Jodie Foster is. And again, however you feel about sort of the maudlin little man Tate, it was a hell of a directorial debut. Anyway, blah, blah, blah. Throw some love Foster's way. And the way she covers that fucking dinner scene is masterful. And again, you can tell, maybe you can't tell it, sorry, you can't tell that it takes 2 weeks to do, but that is the worst kind of scene when you're a director. You've got a dining room table with eight fucking characters around it. Have at it. Like, how are you going to shoot that shit?
Talking over each other, facing different directions.
It's
food continuity.
It's brutal. Like, I don't want
to. Most difficult possible thing.
Yeah,
that doesn't involve an exploding car, but more difficult than an exploding car, really, in certain ways.
In certain ways, yeah, I think so. And that scene is just.
I'm glad you mentioned the thing about the rehearsal too, because I mean that is, like, you know, sometimes people don't know. You know, we've been around in the Hollywood film thing a little bit.
Yeah.
A lot of times, you know, actor just shows up on the day and kind of says, "Okay, what the fuck am I supposed to say today?"
Yeah.
Into a film shoot, and that's why. You know, that's why you get some really disjointed, scattered kind of filmmaking going on, because there's no respect for preparation.
Yeah, right.
Let's say it's not the actor's fault. It's just there's not adequate respect for that kind of for the preparation it takes to really craft a scene in Hollywood. They just expect you to show up and be a brilliant actor. That's not how it works. It's not like people show up and like, oh, you're just a brilliant actor. You'll figure this out. Yeah. Even people who are medium or average actors can become something wonderful if you prepare and
prep them. Yes.
Give them ideas of things to do. And so it makes me happy that you said that she did that because it's obviously evident.
Yeah. No. And it's a type of script that, I love the fact that she, acknowledged that, boom, need 2 weeks of rehearsal with these people to make this work. And it stands out. It really stands out for me. Ladies and gentlemen, I know it sounds crazy to like fucking somehow you've just listened to a podcast that just went all the way through fucking New York and fucking Ryan O'Neal and Tatum O'Neal got name dropped, Frank Langella and Dracula and Big Trouble in Little China and Buckaroo Banzai, and then wham, we end on Home for the Holidays. But because this is a podcast celebrating the absolutely wacky fucking career of WD Richter, this is what you get, man, if you go through this guy's oeuvre. And even if you throw in Brubaker in there, and I haven't seen Nickelodeon, but that's a Peter Bogdanovich. It sounds pretty groovy.
No, we don't need to. It's a trilogy. He made the trilogy.
Okay, all right,
it's
fine.
It's just the weirdest trilogy ever.
Ever.
It doesn't stand out as a trilogy. He probably wouldn't say it is.
Yeah.
But I'm calling it a trilogy right now.
I dig it.
The trilogy of Buckaroo Banzai, Big Trouble in Little China, and the Home for the
Holidays.
The climax.
Yes, which is strange. So my weird hope is that this dude will crawl back to genius, that some random movie will drop in the next 10 years or so, and we'll get one more. It'll be a quadrology of some kind of crazy genius, but who knows? So we usually move into issues. My issue is just this late for dinner thing I'm trying to get my way through, which is his second directorial thing. The main thing that's a bit cringeworthy is that Peter Berg, a very young Peter Berg, is playing a mentally slow individual, and for some reason they give him endless voiceover, and it's embarrassing. It's embarrassingly bad. Avoid late for dinner. My big issue is late for dinner. I don't know. It makes me worried that he was an accidental genius, but I doubt it. I think it's just, that was the second movie he got a chance to direct or whatever, and he just, we swing and we miss. We swing and we miss.
Yes, that happens.
That happens. And it's entirely possible stealth happens. Is also another is another massive strike. I don't know. I never bothered to see it.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe somebody can comment on it. Dom, any particular issues you want to bring up for Mr. Richter?
My issue is still, why is that movie called Home for the Holidays? Are they trying to do something subversive? Mm. You know, I'm a nerd for titles. I like the title that, you know, a cool title. And it's whatever. Home for the Holidays is not a cool title.
Not a cool title. It's not a cool title. It is the name of the short story. So there is that. I don't know.
Okay. Well, fine. Yeah. But I mean, it sounds like a crappy holiday movie. I want to think they did it so that they could get that crowd in to watch this actually subversive film about, you know, family relations and the gay guy's story and all that shit.
Yeah.
I don't know, because I can't think of any other reason, because that title just sucks.
Yes, it sucks.
And it off-puts people who are missing a good film.
Yes.
Because it sounds like a crappy one. Yeah. Anyway, that's my issue.
The only other, the last thing I'll say is your interesting trilogy is that all three of these movies underperformed at the box office when they were first released. As far as I know, Home for the Holidays has not really still, quote unquote, found its audience the way Big Trouble and Buckaroo Banzai did. But all of these, all three of these movies were massively underappreciated when they first were released. Just so we know. So there is that. Okay, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow, whew, that was a good one.
That was some. That was a good one. Yeah, I feel good about that. I don't know why. That just felt.
I feel kind of good.
I feel kind of good right now, right?
I feel kind of good right now, right?
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm doing the Big Trouble in Little China hand sign to Dominic right now. If you don't know what that is, that's the.
I'm putting thing in my ear.
All right, there it is. Cool. There it is. So we always wind up with talking a little bit about what we're working on. Dom, what you got going these days? What's going on this week?
Oh. I'm working on my novella. It's going well. I want to get some illustrations involved in it in its final form and start talking about that. I'm not guaranteeing I'm going to finish it within National Novel Writing Month, but it's going. I mean, it's so much going to be close to finished. That's like awesome.
Nice, man.
It's going to be so close to finished.
Right.
And you know, because I had one of those, like, I know what's going to happen. Like I had those one of those good like plotting moments when you're just like, oh, and then this is going to happen, and then this is going to happen, and this is where we're going to.
Nice.
So all the little beats, like, I feel good about them. It's just a matter of connecting, actually writing the thing. Nice. But that's so much better than, you know what I'm saying? Like, when that moment, like, that's so much better than not knowing where you're going,
right,
which is the thing that makes you not write the novel, because you don't know where it was actually going.
Right, right.
So I'm very excited about that.
Very cool, very cool. The movie continues to trundle along, hiring people. I can't remember if I've updated you guys. We had an actress that unfortunately we lost. So now we're back into casting and we've made all our offers. We've had everybody pass, unfortunately, for whatever reason, which is disappointing. But we're going to a casting session in London on, the 28th. So that's very exciting. So we will have somebody, unless somehow this pack of humans that shows up doesn't fit the bill. But the thing that feels really good about this project is how crazily international it is. And this is sort of a first time for me. We've got, on set at least, you know, we've got at least two people coming from London. We got Belgians all over it, some U.S. people, not just me, another person coming from L.A. We got a French sound person. We've got a Rwandan fucking gaffer. It's just kind of great. It's one of the cool ass kick ass things about being in Europe and creating stuff on a different continent than where you're from. Sometimes you just you get sort of this international reach, and it's really fucking cool. So that's groovy. So the next thing that we need to we usually tease our next podcast, ladies and gentlemen. We're hoping to maybe have our first guest for episode number 11. We're trying to reach out to Mr. Greg Pack, who Dominic has a relationship with, which is great. And we're going to see if we can't get him on board to talk about all things Greg Packiness.
Comic book writer.
Yeah.
Big, wrote a lot of Marvel series, writes his own independent stuff, and writes that adaptation of Big Trouble when Little China mashed up with Escape from New York. So
there's that. So we're going to try to make that happen for
you. He's an insider on a lot of cool things.
Yes, he's a cool
guy. But we'll see. And if anyone just wants to suggest something, we can, as Chris likes to say, call an audible if anyone in our audience anywhere wanted to suggest something to talk about in an episode. Please do.
Please do. Always. Yeah, we've always got on the WordPress, particularly on the WordPress blog, there's a thing where it's called a suggestion box, but you can write suggestions either on the YouTube page, on freaking iTunes, wherever. And Dom, I keep forgetting to tell you this. We are now available on the Stitcher, if you know what that is.
Oh, yeah. Good.
So we are on Stitcher now as well. You can find us a whole bunch of places. And ladies and gentlemen, we are... It's always an honor and a pleasure to talk to Mr. Dom, and it's even more crazy-making in my brain to think that this is going out to the world. So if you're listening, we thank you, of course, and then as always, if you can, comment, like, subscribe. It always helps us push the stuff, push the thing. We are on the Facebooks as well as the iTunes and all that good stuff. So I think that brings us to a close. Episode 10, The Weird Web of WD Richter.
I can't go without humming the theme music to the end of Buckaroo Banzai.
Please do.
We didn't really mention how good that part is.
We didn't. Please take us out, bro.
Dude, all Jeff Goldblum figures out on piano. He's like, do 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 do. You know, it sounds like it's like fantastic. A kid's disco. It's so happy.
We're happy, and we love you, people, and we'll see you later.
Bye.
Ciao. Do 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 do